some of you had might have heard that song before, but it's my first time playing Awesome. Did y'all like Awesome this morning? Did that song touch your heart? Amen. So we're here this morning, and we want to go into what God has brought on my heart. And I always like to talk about old stuff. You know me. I mean, you know, the amazing thing is, you know, I went through some stuff in my life, and I always want to, I love to, you know, make sure that everybody experiences what I experienced, to know that I'm just a normal guy who's been through some normal things, who's had some normal challenges in his life, and I'm real excited to express that to everybody. So I want to tell you about the history. I know y'all remember last week we were talking about my old car, my 79 Toyota Corolla. Did anybody laugh at my 79 Toyota Corolla, knowing that y'all probably had a car similar? Just letting you know, I love that 79 Toyota Corolla, but today I just want to talk about some other stuff. I want to talk about a dog that I had years ago. Yeah, I got to talk about my dogs, you know. I had some dogs years ago, and I've had a bunch of dogs, you know. My mom, you know, allowed us to bring some dogs, and we had some strays. Y'all know them strays, right? So we had some strays in our household, and we brought this one dog in, and I was able to name him. And so I named him Bandit. Y'all don't know where it came from. Now, maybe some of y'all old folks may know where it came from. But I named him Bandit. And I had another dog named Smokey. Yes. Y'all know what I'm talking about now, right? All the young folks are like, what are you talking about? Old folks understand that Bandit related to Smokey and the Bandit. That was one of my favorite shows back in the day. I used to watch that show, you know, every time it came on, every time the movie came on, I watched it. Now, how many people in here watch Smokey and the Bandit? Don't act like you all young and stuff. Everybody in here has probably seen Smokey and the Bandit. Is that correct? And I remember some of the sayings from Smokey and the Bandit. And those sayings, I mean, you might have hated Buford T. Justice, but you loved him in some ways because he made you laugh. Buford was funny. He said some odd stuff. He was K country. Anybody know what K country is, right? C country is normal folks. K country is those folks who are abnormal. Now, that was my family, so that's why I liked Buford T. Justice, and I love some of the things he used to say. You know, and then he used to always talk about his son. His son, who was Junior. Y'all remember Junior? My brother's name was Junior, so we had some K country back in our household. So Buford T. Justice used to always say some things. He used to say some funny things. You know, I remember the one where his son said, Daddy, my hat blew off. Y'all remember that one? He said, my hat blew off. He said, son, I hope your head went with it. And, you know, those things used to make me laugh. I used to love me some Buford T. Justice because he would say things that are so abnormal. My funniest saying, though, was that when Buford was talking to his son, and he said, son, there is no way that you come from my loins. Y'all remember that one? There is no way you come from my loins. And the first thing I'm gonna do when I get home is punch your mama. Y'all remember that? Do y'all know? I know I'm not the only one who did. But Bandit would always bark at people, and no matter who came to the door, whether it was friends, you could be his friend yesterday, but you come to the house today, he gonna bark at you like he didn't know you. He had like some type of amnesia. And so Bandit would even bark at me if I rang the doorbell and was at the front door and I was standing there. He would bark at me also. Now, Bandit had this thing. And I can remember my mom always saying it. Because every time we opened the door, it was great. Bandit was the attack dog. He made people understand you couldn't break into Gray's house. You couldn't do that. Because if you broke into Gray's house, you were going to have to deal with Bandit. Bandit had some problems, though. Every time we opened the door, Bandit was barking. He was doing his job. He was growling at everybody. However, if you opened the screen door, not only did Bandit not bark anymore, but he shot out the screen door and would not come back no matter who called him. And so my mom had this thing. She would always say, don't open that screen. And shoo, Bandit was going out the door. And now here's the funny thing. Bandit knew me. He loved me. He would kiss me and follow me all around the house. But when he got outside, he was a whole different person. I'd be like, come here, Bandit. Come here, Bandit. Come here, Bandit. to you, like, then he take off. And so no matter what I did, I couldn't get Bandit back in the house. Now, here's the funny thing. If I walked up the street, Bandit followed me just far enough where I couldn't catch him. I'd be like, looking at him, he'd be looking at me. I'd be looking at him, he'd be looking at me. And then as soon as I reached for him, he'd take off again. That's how Bandit was. He was just that person. But no matter where I went, he would follow me. Now, I say that for a reason, because one night Bandit followed me and I went to the store with my friends. And the store that I was going to, I had to cross the highway. I had to cross a main street, actually. And it was Rittman Road. And as I was crossing the street, Bandit came with me, and Bandit got hit by a car. And when Bandit got hit by a car, I didn't know what to do after that. Because that was my first time experiencing death. I didn't know nothing about death. I didn't know nothing about how that stuff worked. And so Bandit got killed. And Bandit was in the street, and I was like, what? This is amazing. I don't know how to address this right now. And so when that happened, I went home crying, and I told my mom about it. Y'all know my mom, she K-Country. She believe in the old style stuff. She don't believe in all the new style stuff. She believe in doing stuff the right way. And so Bandit, my mom said, the dog's dead? And she said, yeah. I said, yes. And, you know, I was just all sad and stuff. And my mom said, well, okay, well, go get the dog. I'm like, go get, he's squished in the street. I'm not going to get the dog. No, y'all going to get the dog. Who's going to get the dog? Just go get the dog. It's like, why don't we just leave them there? We see them dogs all the time when we ride by in the car. They all squished in the street. We just leave them. They squished. They part of the street now. There's no longer Bandit anymore. It's Rittman Road. That's what he's called now. He's not Bandit anymore. Mom said, go get the dog. So we got up and we went, and my brother went and picked up the dog. And my mom is not the type who believes in the disposal fee that the vet and all that gives you when you take your dog in and say, hey, my dog died. And they give you that disposal fee. But my mom didn't believe in the disposal fee. She believed in the old-fashioned way of doing things. She said, bring him home. We're going to bury him in the backyard. Y'all know that's my cake country. I don't know about your country, but that's mine. And so we brought him home, and we buried him in the backyard. And it was the most biggest trial in my life. It changed some things on the way I thought, because the next day I woke up and I was expecting Bandit to be there. Now I know some of y'all have experienced death in your lives before, and the next day you wake up and it's like, wow, he's really not there. And I woke up the next day after that and I was calling for Bandit, and Bandit never showed up again. And I woke up the next day, and I did that for a whole week. I kept on waking up and thinking it was a dream, that it could not have happened. Has anybody ever experienced death to where you wake up and it's like, man, I can't believe that this person is really gone? So I experienced death for the first time in my life at the young age. And I remember, you know, thinking to myself, man, my mom just buried a dog in the backyard of my house. I hope none of us die. Because mom is K-Country. She might be like, oh, I love that kid. I really love that kid. Larry, can you go dig a ditch in the backyard? You know, that's how my family is. I don't know about your family, but my family believes in doing it the old-fashioned way. So I just had to say that because, you know, it made me wonder about life when I experienced death for the first time. The reason you appreciate life is when you experience death, when you experience somebody who's passed on in your life. So I say that for this reason. In my ignorance, I thought that God was unjust in doing what he did. I thought that he was unjust in taking my dog at that age. I thought he was unjust. I thought he was not right for doing what he did. I was like, man, why do you have to allow me to witness my dog getting killed in front of me? So I thought he was unjust. I thought he was a bully. I didn't think he was the God I was looking for. And I had visions, and I was like, man, I can't believe this. God would do this thing to me. Has anybody ever experienced a time where you looked at God and said, man, I can't believe you would allow me to go through this? Am I the only one? If you've experienced that, I want to hear an amen this morning. So I experienced that in my life, and I want to say that before for a reason, because I didn't realize that he had a plan that I couldn't stop. And that plan had nothing to do with my feelings, but it had everything to do with me. He had a plan that was bigger than me, and because I was in my ignorant stage, I didn't see that. I couldn't see where I was going. I only seen where I was at right at that moment. I seen the death in my life. How many people have screamed at God before? Say, God, why are you taking me here? Why are you allowing me to go through this? Why are you allowing me to experience this pain? You can't be a God if you're allowing me to experience pain. This is not right. I didn't know that the pain was being pushed in my life to build character in me. Pain always builds character, but I didn't know that when I was going through it. When it's pain, it's pain. Look, I didn't know that the plan was being pushed by everything that I was going through. I didn't know that God had a plan for me since the very beginning. I thought I was just living haphazardly, just walking and talking and doing whatever I wanted. God had a plan for me, and I didn't know that. But I started to realize years later that the things I went through in the past had everything to do with what I'm dealing with in the future. And it made me smile at God because I realized that it wasn't just me going through that death in my life. That death helped me through the death that I dealt with later on in my life. It made me experience that trials and tribulations happen, but they happen to grow you, not to cause you problems. And I didn't realize that. So I did not realize that the plan was finished before I was created. See, I thought that everything just happened and you just created things and destroyed things in your life. And sometimes we don't realize the vision that God had for us. God created the end at the beginning, which means that everything we go through, he had already planned. He already knew that you were going to go through some stuff. He already knew that you were going to have some challenges in your life. So I say that for this reason. And I want you to write this down. I want you to write this down. Write Genesis 25, that's talking about Jacob and Esau. I want you to realize that, you know, last week I was talking about my 79 Toyota Corolla, and I was so proud of my 79 Toyota Corolla because it had so many features to it. Y'all remember my car from last week? You remember all them features it had on it? It had that price tag that was $525. I was all excited about the $525. Remember, it was $585 first, so I negotiated. I was the negotiating guy. Went to the guy, said, I want it for $525. He said, sold. He said, you just have the cash now. I said, yeah. He said, it's sold. So I was excited about the 79 Toyota Corolla. I was real excited about it. And, you know, I enjoyed that price. I enjoyed all the different things about it. I enjoyed the tires that were bald as can be. And we call them May Pops. That means that may pop at any second. Or, you know, you can hit a bump wrong and it'll pop. You can hit a piece of dirt wrong and it'll pop. You know, don't matter. Them cars. But I was happy. I wasn't worried about the tires. I wasn't worried about the door hinge that came off. I wasn't worried about any of that. I wasn't worried about the windows that barely rolled up. Y'all remember that window that barely rolled up? I had one. It rolled up and it shifted a little bit. You know, don't act like y'all ain't had those type of cars before. People could break in your car, but I had an alarm on it anyways, even before it was painted. I told you about that. I had an alarm. Choo-choo. I was happy about that. And I had all that stuff with my car, and I was excited about that, and I told you about Frank. Frank had this other car. He had the same type of car, but he beat his car up, and I had my car with 175,000 miles on it. His car had 300,000 miles on it, and I was upset because my car broke, and the engine went out on it, and it only had 175,000, and I was expecting it to get at least 300,000 because Frank did all that he did. Frank tore his car up. I fixed everything on my car. I fixed that window. It rolled up completely. I was happy about that. I put the illegal tint on it so nobody can see me before it was painted. Then after it was painted, I rolled them windows down. You know how it was. So I did all that, and I talked about Joseph and how Joseph dealt with his family and his brothers, how they hated him just because he was favored by the father. And so Joseph's brothers hated him also when he talked about the dream that he had. He talked about how they would serve him. And they hated that. They hated the fact that he spoke that. And so they wanted to try to change a vision, a prophetic vision that God had gave him. But the thing about prophetic visions is they've already happened. You're just waiting for time to catch up to them. So you can't change a prophetic vision. I can't change the vision that God has given me over church. Because it's already happened. He's given me a vision of something that's happened, not a vision of something that might happen. A vision of something that might happen is called a dream. Does everybody understand the difference between a dream and an actual vision? So God gives you the vision, and when he gives you those prophetic visions, you have to understand that those things are meant for a purpose, not to show you what might happen, but to show you what has happened. already played out. It's already happened. The end and the beginning has already happened. It's happened time and time again because he's not listed by time. So that excited me. And in dealing with my car, I realized that, you know, my car was a jealous car. It always winked and was a flirt. It always flirted at other folks. Y'all know some of y'all had those flirting cars also. Anybody ever had those flirting cars? I'm going to tell you what it did. You know, when you're driving at night and somebody's in front of you, it always winks at the person in front. That's what it did. It winked. Everybody, I'm like, why are you winking at folks? It just fluttered. You know that light that fluttered? Y'all had them lights. Stop acting like you ain't had a headlight like that always flutters like that when you're driving. Y'all know what I'm talking about now, right? That's the kind of car I had. I had that light that fluttered. And no matter what I did, it fluttered. Every single place I went, it was fluttering. Till I finally learned how to change it. And when I changed it, I put the light upside down. I didn't know you could do that. And here's what happened when it was upside down. When you turn the light on at night, it shined at the top of the roof. And so I had that car. And I say that for a reason, because I planned for the car to live forever. I planned for the car to get me through years. But God had a plan for it that I couldn't stop. I could change the color. I could fix it up. I could have the engine running perfectly. But I could not change the plan that God had for that car. And Frank could have had my car. If Frank had my car with 175,000 miles, it would have kept on running and running, because God had a plan for Frank with that car. For me with the car, it was planned to go out at the right time, and no matter what car I had, it would have stopped that day, that time, because it was God's vision, God's plan. So you got to understand, in life, we can't change what God has already planned for you. You can change little certainties of what happens in your life, but you cannot change the plan. That's what we said with Joseph. His brothers tried and tried. They tried to kill him because they wanted to stop the vision that he had. His brothers tried and tried. They threw him in a pit because they tried to get him away from serving, of them being able to serve him. And throwing him into the pit, they only pushed him into his destiny by doing that. No matter what they did, they could have kept him at home and been blessing him, and he still would have went into his destiny, but they did the opposite and tried to push him away from his destiny. But it was already a vision that was created, and God based it on what the brothers were going to do. He based it on what Joseph was going to do. He based it on what the Egyptians were going to do. He based it on what the Ishmaelites were going to do. He based it on what everybody was going to do before anybody knew it. And so I'm telling you this so that you understand that God has a purpose and a plan for every one of us, and we can't mess it up. All we got to do is follow him. Now, in Genesis 25:19, I want you to write that down. Genesis 25:19, this is talking about Jacob and Esau. Anybody familiar with Jacob and Esau? And I want to read this. Genesis 25. Actually, I'm going to start from 21. This is Isaac talking. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife. Because she was barren, she could not have kids. The Lord answered his prayer, and his wife, Rebekah, became pregnant. The babies jostled each other within her. And she said, why is this happening? So she's wondering why these things are happening inside of her. She's wondering why these kids are tussling around. And then the Lord said to her, this is the vision that God has given her. He's telling her the things that are going to happen. He said, two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger. Do y'all hear that? There was nothing else done. The kids weren't even born yet, and God already said the older will serve the younger. Now, does it matter who the older is? If Jacob was the older one, would he be serving Esau? Yes, he would. If Esau was the older one, would Esau be serving Jacob? Yes, he would. It was not based on their name. It was not based on anything they'd done. It was not based on anything the mom had done. None of them had done anything yet for those kids. But God already said that the older will serve the younger. So So there are things that God plans for our lives that we couldn't change if we wanted to. Do y'all understand that? So, Jacob, in explaining that, it basically said that the favor of God was on Jacob, but the favor of God wasn't on Esau. So God loved Jacob, but Esau he basically hated. Now here's the thing. Did Esau grow up and have a bad life? No. He grew up, he was a hunter, he was an avid hunter, and he did everything right. He loved his parents. He took care of his father. He took care of his mother. He wasn't a bad guy. You would think if God hated somebody, they would die immediately, wouldn't you? They would be struck down with some illness, wouldn't they? They would live a terrible life, wouldn't they? But Esau was born, lived a great life. He didn't have any problems in his life. He was living right with his family. He was taking care of his mother and father. He did everything they said. There was nothing that they said that was negative, that he didn't, or as far as him not listening to him, he didn't rebel against them. He didn't do any of that. But this is somebody that God hated. So you have to understand how that works. Jacob, he loved. Esau, he hated. That simply meant that the blessing of God was on Jacob, but the blessing of God was not on Esau. Now, I want you to understand this clearly. Jacob was a quiet guy, but he was a schemer. Now, this is the one that's supposed to have the favor of God on him. He was a schemer. He always pushed to push the envelope to try to get things. He did what he had to do. He lied. He cheated. He did all those things. This is supposed to be a person who God loved. Now, Esau was a hunter. Esau, was the type of person who was, if he was hungry, he'd give you anything. He didn't give you anything to eat. And so what happened was Esau was hungry one day, and he went to Jacob, and Jacob had some food. And Esau asked for the food, and Jacob said, I'll make you food if you sell me your birthright. Now, this is Jacob. Jacob is the one that God loved. And yet he's doing things that are not right. He's telling them, look, I want you to sell me your birthright. You know what the birthright meant? I want to make sure you understand that. In the ancient law, the birthright was always given to the older son. The older son had the authority. The older son received more of the inheritance. The older son had more power. The older son was always blessed by the father. That's a birthright. That's what they did. And so for him to sell his birthright, to say, I want to sell my blessing, I want to sell it to you for a meal, that says even though he was a good man, even though he was doing things right, even though he was an avid hunter, even though he was a go-getter, he still was not a man after God's own heart. Now, there's a difference, because sometimes people think, because I go to school, because I do things right, because I don't cause sin, because I don't do anything wrong, I'm right with God. That doesn't make you right with God. You can live a life of good or you can live a life of bad. But the only thing that makes you right with God is the blood of Jesus Christ. That's it. Some people think I can go to church for 20 years and do things right and be right with God. That doesn't make you right with God. God's chosen plan for you makes you right with God. So Jacob, even though he was a schemer, even though he did things by any means necessary, even though he was a liar, even though he was a deceiver, he still was chosen by God. Now, did the choosing of God have anything to do with his life on earth? No. It had nothing to do with his life on earth, but everything to do with God choosing him. So, what makes me excited in here is because you have to know that the only reason you're here is not because of the good things you've done in your life. It's not because you lived the perfect life, because I'm not the only person who has not lived the perfect life. If we have some misfits in here, I want you to raise your hand and say hallelujah this morning. If we've had some people who've lied before, I want you to say hallelujah this morning. If we've had some cheaters in here, I want you to scream like you've never screamed before. I know I'm not talking about just myself. I'm talking about everybody in here. None of us is innocent. But the beautiful thing about God is that you were selected by him and he knew what you were going to do. He knew that you were going to do wrong. He knew that you were going to mess up. But it wasn't based on that because he chose you before you were created. Isn't that awesome? So the love of God was in Jacob. Esau was the one who sold his birthright for a meal. Esau was the one who took care of the family. Esau was the one who done things right. But Esau didn't have the favor of God upon him. Now I say that for a reason, because with Joseph was a good man. He was a good man. And he deserved for his brothers to respect him. And they did not respect him because he was saying a vision that God gave him. And so they didn't respect that. And, you know, sometimes we look at it and we say, well, I'm not a Joseph. I'm not a good person. I haven't done everything right in my life. I haven't had the visions from God. I haven't lived the perfect life. I had sex before I was married. I went out there. I was promiscuous. I've done drugs before. I've done all those bad things before. So I don't deserve God. Well, Joseph deserved God, but Jacob didn't. And yet Jacob had God. So I'm telling you, if you're a misfit, God still loves you because he brought you here this morning. And he chose you to come here this morning before you were created, because there was nothing that Jacob could do to stop the birthright from being given to him. Now, here's the funny thing. He went out and pursued the birthright from his brother. If he would not have pursued the birthright from his brother, he would have still gotten it. You know why? Because the word was spoken before he was even created, that the older would serve the younger. Do y'all understand that? So here's the thing. He ran after the birthright. He ran after the blessing. He did deceiving things. If you read 25 through 27, chapter 27, you'll find that Jacob did some deceiving things with his mom, Rebekah. Jacob would say, you know, when his mom loved Jacob more than she loved Esau. And it specifically said that the father loved Esau more than he loved Jacob. And Jacob and the mom did some deceiving things. The mom, when the father was getting old and he couldn't see and his vision was being lost, and, you know, he knew he was about to pass, he knew he was about to die, and so he told Esau, he said, you're the oldest son. I want you to go out and do what you do. I want you to hunt an animal. I want you to kill that animal. I want you to bring that animal back. I want you to prepare me a dinner, and then I'm going to bless you. See, the awesome thing is a man of God can bless another man and pass on his inheritance and pass on his blessing just by honoring God. So he did that. He said, I want you to go out and do these things and come back, and then I'm going to bless you. So he went back. He went out to hunt. Now, the problem was that the mom heard that. And the mom went to Jacob and said, Jacob, this is what I want you to do. I want you to grab one of our animals. I want you to kill him so that I can prepare the food for your dad. And I want you to take this food to your dad. And then I want you to act like your brother, because he can't see you. He can barely hear you. Go act like your brother so that you can get blessed. See, once you get blessed, he can't take the blessing back. So the brother did that, and the Jacob went out and got the animal, and Esau was out hunting the animal, and Jacob went out and got the animal, and Jacob brought the animal back, and the mom prepared it, and Jacob took it in there, and the father was kind of suspicious, but because he doctored himself up to be like his brother, the father blessed him and gave him the birthright, gave him the inheritance that he was supposed to receive, Esau was supposed to receive. But if you look at the word, then you understand that God said way before. He said that the older would serve the younger. He didn't have to do all those bad things to receive what God had for him. But he did. And when the other brother came back, the other brother was upset because his birthright, his blessings was given to his brother. And he talked to the father about it. The father said, I can't change it. I can't change it. It's already done. I can't take back a blessing that I've given him. I've already blessed him and gave him the inheritance. And then, you know what the father told him? The father said, well, it looks like you're going to be serving your brother. And so the word that was spoken before they were born came to fruition. All that happened was that time caught up with reality. So I say that for the reason of us getting ourselves right with God. You don't have to feel condemned for things you've done in your past. You don't have to feel that you're not in the right place. How many people, I know I've woken up and said this before, have woken up and said, man, I don't know if I'm in the right place in God where I'm supposed to be. How many people say, I don't know if I'm doing enough for the kingdom. I don't know if I'm where I need to be. I want to see all the hands coming up now. How many people have said that before? I'm here to tell you, you can't mess up God. If he has a plan, if he has a destiny for your life, you will meet that destiny. Can I get an amen this morning? You have to understand where you are in Christ. They tried to stop Joseph. They only catapulted him. Jacob tried to push what he wanted from Esau. God said he was going to get it anyways. And so he tried to push for something. He tried to make something happen. Sometimes we try to work too hard for something that God has already prepared for us to have. Have you ever seen a person that you work with or that you know who's always seems to have money, always seem to be blessed, but they make the same amount of money you make? Am I the only one who's experienced folks like that? And they're out there, they're always blessed, they always got the nice cars, and they always have paid off houses and all that stuff, and you're like, man, what's going on? It's called the blessing of God. Some people God bless, some people God choose for dishonor. Blessings for honor, curses for dishonor. He chooses one or the other. Now, people say, well, where's the show that at? I want you to turn in your Bibles to Romans. Romans 9. Sometimes God allows people to be in our lives to change who we are as people and understand, walk more to the blesser instead of the blessing. Romans 9:10 talks about this. Romans 9:10 says this, and it's talking about the same people. It says, not only that, but Rebekah's children had one of the same father, Father Isaac, yet before the twins were born or had done anything good, in order that God's purpose in election might stand, not by works, but by him who calls, she was told, the older will serve the younger. Just as it is written, Jacob I love, Esau I hated. When this word is saying that God hates somebody, it doesn't mean he hates them to the point of destroying. It means that God is sovereign. He is an almighty God. Everything begins and ends with him. When he says, I bless you, you have to be blessed. It is his spoken word. But he can't use some people for wrath and some people for honor and say, I bless you both. Because if he blesses you both, you're the same. And so he chooses some for honor and he chooses some for dishonor. So when he says he hates, that means he takes his blessing off of them. So it says the older will serve the younger. And then verse 14 says, what then shall we say? Is God unjust? Because every time we see something bad go on in our life, we say God is unjust. Isn't that us? We say God is an unjust God. Why does he do these things to me? I go to church every week. Why does he allow my car to break down and it be $1,000 to fix? Has anybody ever experienced that before? Why does he allow my bank account? Why do I have this bill come in that all of a sudden popped up and now I got to pay $1,000 that I don't have? Why does he allow me to go through that? Why does he allow me to go through sibling rivalries? Why do I always got to be fighting with my sister, be fighting with my brother? Why do I always got to be fighting with my family? Why can't we just all get along? I'm trying to show the love of God, but every time I show love, wrath always comes. They always want to attack me. Why is it always got to be my relationship that goes bad? I've tried, God, you know in my heart I want to be married. You know in my heart I want family. You know in my heart I want children. You know in my heart I want the picket fence. I want all that good stuff. But I can't have it because I keep going through these things. Why me? How many people in here do I have anybody who's experienced that before? Why is it my businesses always fail? I try and I try. I put the faith in. I get on my knees. I pray to you. And yet I still have failure after failure in these businesses. And I'm telling you, it's all a part of God's plan for everyone. You have to know that you're still walking in the plan that he has for your life. No matter what Jacob did, he was still going to receive that birthright. But he tried to push for it. He was scheming. And it still says here, if I'm reading it right, that Jacob I loved. Is not that what it says? It says that Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. Now, if you read up on it, you'll read that Jacob was a bad man. He did so many bad things. He was so scheming and negative towards things. But why is it God blessed him? You know why? Because it ain't had nothing to do with his life. It had everything to do with what God predicted and spoke upon him before he was created. So I'm telling you this so that you don't just think that everybody needs to be a Joseph to have their life blessed. I'm telling you that the reason you are here is because God selected you to be here. I'm telling you that God had a plan for you since the very beginning of time. And it had nothing to do with all that stuff you went through. All that stuff did was build character in you and make you a better person in God. And so some of us, you know, I want to keep reading this. Verse 14, what then shall we say? Is it God unjust? And it says, not at all. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Now, that sounds like a God who does whatever he wants. Is that the God we're talking about? He has ultimate power. He's all power, almighty, all knowing, everything. Which means that he has all authority. Which means that he created the end at the beginning. Which means that he's not just flipping a coin on your life. He had your life planned to be here. That's why I'm excited every week, because I know that God had a plan for me, and the plan was much bigger than me. And so everything I went through in my life with my car, everybody loves my car. I still know where that car is. Anybody want to buy the car for me? 79 Toyota Corolla for sale. $600. You would buy that. You do it for me, man. You my homeboy. You going to buy that? You got $600 in your pocket? I thought so. Dang, man. So I say that for us to get this right. God says he will have mercy on whom he will have mercy, and he will have compassion on whom he has compassion. And then verse 16 says this, it does not therefore depend on man's desire or effort, but on God's mercy. Now, I didn't say that. The word says that, right? Does it say it depends on God's mercy? God had mercy on Jacob before Jacob did anything. God had mercy on you before you did anything in your life. So if he had mercy on you, why do you condemn yourselves for things? The Bible says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You know what that means? It means God says, y'all acting like I'm dumb. Y'all acting like I didn't know you were going to sleep with somebody. You acting like I didn't know you were going to resist me years ago. You acting like I didn't know you were going to get into all those temptations. You act like I didn't know you were going to lie and cheat. You act like I didn't know you were going to have that hardened heart. You act like I didn't know that. Like I'm not God, and I didn't know you were going to end up here this morning. It's like he's at the front of the room surprised. Oh, you showed up? No, it's not. That's not how it works with God. God knows you. He knows you better than you know yourself. He stops you from things you want to do in life because he knows that's not a good pathway for you. And sometimes you're saying, oh, I want to be a musician. I want to be a rapper. I want to be a singer. I want to be a this. I want to be a dancer. I want to be this. And you God said, okay, I'm going to give them a taste of it because I know they're going to want some. But that's not what I want for them. That's not the plan I have for them. And my plan is always bigger than their plans. He says his ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And sometimes we try to take on the mind of Christ, but without understanding that he had a plan since the beginning. The grace of God is that you know that he has a plan. That's what wakes me up and says, man, I know God is for me. I know he's for me because everything I've been through, every trial I've been through in my life, he shows me something that always makes up for the death that happened in my life, that always makes up for the trials and the persecutions that I've been through. It always makes up for it. And see, when you're tuned into God, he'll start showing you things. He'll start throwing them little kibbles and bits out to you. And every day you walk in, you get a taste of something. Every day you walk, you picked up another nugget, and you're like, man, that nugget was good. Oh, that's why you did that 25 years ago. That's why you did that 35 years ago. That's why you did that 15 years ago. That's why you did that last week. When you start tapping into God, he will start telling you about your life and why he did things for you. He made me understand that death in my life that happened around me and not to me, because he had a plan for me. So, you know, it says it does not depend on man's desire or effort, but God's mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, I raised you up for this very purpose, that I might display my power in you. And if you read this, verse 22 says, what if God, choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction? What if he did this to make his riches of glory known to the objects of his mercy, whom he prepared in advance? Do you hear that? Who he prepared in advance for glory. That makes you understand completely and say, man, God, I didn't just pop up here. You chose me to be here. I'm not doing the big justice for you. You're doing the big justice for me. The healing I got, you prepared since the very beginning. All he wanted us to do was pray for it and receive it. You are healed because we prayed for it years ago. All we did was walk up and catch up with time, and it makes you healed. It makes you restored. It makes you broken of every form of addiction in your life. It makes you destroyed of every bad relationship. It makes you renewed in your spirit. It makes you renewed in your mind. It makes me freed from all the past that I had. These are the things that you understand about your life. You smile not because you've broken something. You smile that you know that it was broken before you were created. That's what excites me about God. So some of us stress so much, and we try to force God's hand. Jacob tried to force God's hand, and God already said, Jacob, you have it. I don't know why you're doing all this, but you have it already. But Jacob tried to push and scheme and do all those wrong things. John 6:44 says this. It says, no one comes to Christ unless drawn by the Father. If you're drawn by the Father, that means God selected you since the very beginning. Does he draw you because you're doing right? Does he draw you because you're doing wrong? No, he simply draws you because he can. Understanding that is huge in your life, because now you can no longer be convicted of things. Now you can no longer be condemned of things of your past. You simply let them go because you're following God. See, I know a God who will allow you, if you want to, you can bring all your baggage with you and take it up to him and say, hey, I'm coming as is, as I am, and you can select me or not select me. Now the devil will select you with your baggage. God says, come on through. I'm going to take the baggage off of you though. I'm going to destroy all that debt you have in your life. I'm going to destroy all the destruction that's been there. I'm going to destroy the addictions. I'm going to destroy the persecution. I'm going to take all that stuff off of you. I'm going to rip it off you, but you're going to try to walk in with it. So I used to think there was 1,000 different pathways, and I learned that there are only two pathways. I want you to write that down. There are only two pathways to God. One is bumpy, the other is smooth. Bumpy or smooth? Everybody say bumpy or smooth. How many bumpies we have in here? Bumpies, raise your, look at all the bumpies. That's a shame. All the bumpies, I'm a bumpy too. Wouldn't you like to be a bumpy too? How many smooths do we have? There's no smooths in here. There's one smooth. Oh, but how old are you? You 14, you can't be a smooth. You too early. You still got milk on your mouth. You can't do that. I'm jealous of you, man. At 14, I don't know what I was doing. I was throwing papers at people. Good stuff, man. Great stuff. Bumpy or smooth? Both of them lead to God. Now, how many people have had a smooth life where everything went right and you served God since the very beginning of your life and everything's been smooth? You've been going to church every week. You play in the choir that we don't have. How many people doing that? How many people? Raise your hand. I want to bring you up and shake your hand. So all of us are living that bumpy life, right? Is that what we're doing? We didn't listen. How many people didn't listen? people have rejected God at times? How many people have rebelled? How many people have cursed at God before? Mm-hmm. So when, you know, there's two ways to this place, but they all lead the same place. You can go left and go all the way around, but you're going to end up in the same place. You're still here. You can go down the street and go to the right and go all the way around, but you're still going to end up here. You can have a perfect life and everything work right for you, but you're still going to end up here. Because you cannot change the plan that God has for you. You cannot change that. You can change what you wear every day. You can change how your car looks. You can change how you clean your house. You can change how you take care of your kids. But you cannot change the plan. And you ought to be shouting hallelujah for that. Because he said, in spite of all the things you've done, in spite of the bad ways you've acted, I still have you here. And you're here because I planned it since the very beginning of time. That's what you should shout hallelujah and amen for. Now, I know there was more than two bumpy people, so I need to hear a louder hallelujah and amen. Can anybody say hallelujah for the things God has done in your life? Hallelujah. Amen. So I used to complain about, you know, I complained about losing my dog. I was mad because I lost the dog at a young age, and I was mad because the dog got run over by a car. I was mad because we buried the dog in the backyard. I was mad because of all of those things, all those trials that I went through with the dog. I was mad because I woke up a day after that and I was looking for the dog. I was mad because I woke up a week after that and I was looking for the dog. I was mad because I woke up day after day after day and I was looking for that dog, and I was like, God, there's no way. You must be unjust. And God said, look at the wisdom version of this. And when you go into prayer, he starts revealing stuff to you. He said, do you understand that every dog you had since then, you trained? You trained them because you didn't want them to end up like your other dog. And I thought about it. I said, man, every dog I've had, whether it was Smokey, whether it was Bandit, whatever dog I had following that, every one of them was trained not to be in the street because of what I went through with the first dog. Do you understand the wisdom of God? This is how he worked. He said, I was planning you for this. I was planning you for these dogs. Sometimes we have some for honor and some for dishonor. Your dog seemed like he was for dishonor, but he was actually for honor because he made you respect the dogs that you got after that. I complained about the bad relationships. But the bad relationships led to the good relationship. I wouldn't respect my wife. I wouldn't honor my wife if I had not been through some of the bad ones. You wouldn't appreciate people in your life unless you go through the bad people. And so when I went through those and I was crying and saying God is unjust, yes, he's unjust in my ignorance. But when wisdom kicked in, wisdom said, I'm preparing you for the jewel that I'm bringing you. I'm preparing you for the girl that I have for you. I'm preparing you for the beauty that I'm bringing in your life. If you don't go through these bad things, if you don't go through the lying, if you don't go through the deceit, you're not going to learn how to respect the jewel that I bring you. Can I give it an amen up in here this morning? I complained about bad jobs. But I didn't realize that the crawl made me appreciate where I am now and not take it for granted. When you crawl through a job, when you make minimum, when you barely struggle, when you struggle to pay bills, when you rob Peter to pay Paul, when you busting your butt to get things done, when you're struggling and losing jobs and going through trials and going through tribulations, God prepares you for the one he's going to give you to restore you. You won't appreciate it if you ain't been through the bad ones. You won't know how to get up and be on time if you've never been late before. You won't know how to appreciate that and not make excuses and call in if you've never called in before. If you've called in before, you've lost jobs. If you've called in before, you've been terminated. And then you will start appreciating it because God takes you through this trial after trial to where you finally get it, and then wisdom kicks in and says, I was preparing you for this job. This is why I took you away. This is why I allowed you to be terminated. I had a plan since the very beginning of time for you. Jacob I love, Esau I hated. The birthright was given before he was created. Genesis 37, Joseph's brothers couldn't stop the plan that God had for him. Genesis 25, Jacob was scheming and doing all he wanted to do to try to push forth getting the birthright, trying to push forth getting the blessings that God spoke over him since the very beginning, before he was born. So you've got to ask, what has God spoken over you? You're here. The reason you're here is because he planned for you to be here since the very beginning. Now you got to walk with your birthright. Jesus Christ, the one who was, the one who is, the one who is to come. He created you and he also restored you. He created you knowing that Adam was going to mess up, knowing that Adam was going to walk and mess up and eat of the fruit he was not supposed to eat of. He created you knowing that there were going to be years of turmoil. He created you knowing that he was going to once have to give his life that you may have life. So the least you can do is get up every day and enjoy the Lord for what he's done for you. The least you can do is not walk in condemnation for the blessings that he's already received for you. The least you can do is think about God and say, God, I love you enough to stop the things that I've been doing, to stop the bad that I've been doing, to walk away from the drugs, to walk away from the alcohol, to walk away from all the addictions, because I know that my Lord has saved me. And it ain't based on any of that. And so you can't condemn yourself and say, God, I've just done wrong. God is saying, you're made right through Jesus. You're purified through the blood. That's all it takes. So your prayer should be different. Your prayer should be about the excitement of God. When you give up something, you give it up just because it's easy. Look, you know, the men, we've been walking on some things that God has asked us to do, and it's been easy for us. Men, can I get an amen? It's been easy for us. You know why? Because our focus is no longer our flesh. Our focus is our spirit. And we're no longer allowing our spirit to be covered by our flesh. We're allowing our flesh to be destroyed by the spirit. So Proverbs 3:5 says this. It says, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all you do, and he will make your path straight. Look, we've been riding the bumpy road for long enough. Some of y'all been riding it for years. Some of y'all been next to me. I've been honking at you as we rode by in the bumpy road. But now it's time to ride in the straight and smooth. The straight and smooth is understanding that God loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. He knew what you were going to do since the very beginning of time, but he still chose to come down from glory to step down on this earth and say, I'm going to live so that you can live. And you have to be willing to accept that. And accepting that is saying, look, I know I have sin in my life, but I'm not going to use that as a reason to avoid God because he chose me before the sin. You get that? A lot of times we try to focus on God's plan instead of focusing on the grace. We focus on the plan. Well, I don't know what God has for me. I'm so confused. Well, God is not the author of confusion. Sometimes the plan is not meant for you to know. Sometimes if you walk in grace, the plan will walk up to you. When you walking up in grace, see, look, we were singing the song Awesome this morning. Was everybody singing Awesome with me this morning? We were singing that song this morning, and God was saying, look, I'm awesome. He's awesome no matter what he does. He's a deliverer. He's a restorer. He doesn't breach on contracts. So when you understand how awesome he is, you don't walk in condemnation anymore. You allow God to restore you, to renew you of those past things you have done wrong. Lean not to your own understanding, meaning that sometimes you just not going to understand. Sometimes you're just not going to know. I know that God doesn't tell me everything tomorrow. I know that God won't tell me what's going to happen next week all the time. Sometimes he will reveal it to me. But I know what Proverbs 3:5 says. It says, do not lean on your own understanding. It says, just acknowledge me in all I do. Just acknowledge me in all you do, and I'll make your path straight. Don't try to focus on what you're going to do tomorrow. You're not guaranteed tomorrow. You're not guaranteed the rest of this day. He's saying, don't try to figure out when death happens in your life. Know that I am life. Don't try to get confused and say, why did this happen to me? Trust me. Lean not to your own understanding. Know that when my dog passed away, when my dog died, I didn't know that I was going to be a better dog trainer later on in my life. I didn't know that I could help people keep their dogs from getting destroyed. And God says sometimes you won't see it for 20 or 30 years, but you just got to trust me and not lean to your own understanding. So I say that because Romans 10:9 says, confess and believe. Confess and believe. Look, you can walk all your life and have problems, but God says confess and believe. There are going to be issues tonight, but you got to confess and believe. People are going to lie to you. People are going to walk out of your life. People are going to not live up to your expectations, but you got to confess and believe. How many people in here are ready to confess and believe? If I have two people who are ready to confess and believe, jump up and give God glory in the house this morning. I know there's three of you. I know there's four of you. I know there's five of you. I know there's six of you. I know there's seven of you. I know we can get seven people to scream hallelujah this morning. I know that there are eight people who can scream how awesome God is. From this day forward, don't be the same. Don't change. Change your life daily with God. I want you to say this real loud. Say, confess and believe. That's what you need to walk on for the rest of your life. Confess and believe. No matter what happens to you, confess and believe. If death happens, confess and believe. If negativity happens, confess and believe. No matter what happens in your life, this is what we're going to do. We're going to confess and believe. Give God glory in the house this morning.